everyone, welcome to Top Early. From this lecture, we are starting a new lecture series, Nonlinear Control Systems. This is an advanced course and therefore I expect the viewers to have some basic understanding of linear control system theory. So, in case you don't have a background in that area, I encourage you to read a textbook on linear systems as it can come handy later in these lectures. Now, let's start our course. The adjective nonlinear can be interpreted in two different ways. Not linear and not necessarily linear. In the control system sense, this one is intended. Now, why should we study nonlinear systems? We should study nonlinear systems because of the fact that virtually all physical systems are nonlinear in nature. Although sometimes it is possible to describe the operations of a physical system by a linear model, it is done so strictly bounded by the condition that the mode of operation of the physical system does not deviate much from the nominal set of operating conditions. So, in analyzing the behavior of any physical system, one often encounters situations where the linearized model is inadequate or inaccurate. This is where the nonlinear system analysis becomes useful. Another reason is sometimes we need to introduce nonlinearities intentionally into a system. This is done to compensate the effect of other nonlinearities or to obtain better performances. Okay, now we will see what are the differences between linear system or how a nonlinear system differs from a linear system. The main difference between linear and nonlinear systems is that linear systems obey superposition principle while nonlinear systems does not obey superposition principle. I hope that everyone remember what is superposition principle. Superposition principle states that for all linear systems, the net response caused by two or more stimuli is the sum of the responses that would have been caused by each stimulus individually. Mathematically, if y1 is the response of the input u1 and y2 is the response of the input u2 and y3 is the response of u1 plus u2, then for this system to obey superposition principle, y3 should be the sum of y1 and y2. That is superposition principle. The next difference between linear and nonlinear systems is that in the case of linear systems, which can be described by a set of linear ordinary differential equations, it is often possible to derive closed form solutions of the system equations. By closed form, I mean the solution to a differential equation may be sometimes like this, y equal to a e raised to x or y equal to a plus b e raised to x or y equal to a sin x plus b e raised to x plus cos x, etc. The point is, we can get equations that can describe the system in the entire state space. However, with nonlinear systems, this is not the case. We cannot form closed form solutions. All we can have is some predictions about the behavior of the system. This type of analysis is called qualitative analysis or approximate analysis. That is, qualitative analysis or approximate analysis. Now, the third difference is, in the case of linear system, stability depends on the system parameters only. However, when it comes to nonlinear systems, stability depends on initial conditions, input signals, as well as system parameters. Okay. Now, another difference lies in the frequency of system input and output. In linear systems, the output of system has same frequency as input. In nonlinear system, the output frequency usually contains additional frequency components and sometimes don't even contain the input frequency at all. Okay, so these are some major differences between linear systems and nonlinear systems. Now, we will try to define a nonlinear system mathematically. Dynamic system can be modeled by a finite number of coupled first order differential equations given by x1 dot equal to f1 t x1 comma x2 comma x3 etc to xn u1 comma u2 comma u3 etc to un. Similarly, x2 dot equal to f2 t x1 comma x2 comma x3 etc to xn u1 comma
u2 comma u3 comma etc to un, and similarly till xn dot given by f3 of t x1 comma x2 comma etc to xn u1 comma u2 comma etc to un, where this x1 comma x2 comma etc to xn are system parameters, and u1 comma u2 comma etc to un are system inputs. These system parameters can also be called state variables. And just for clarification, xn dot is the time derivative of xn. Now, in order to write this set of equations in a compact form, we can use vector notations. So let us define x equal to x1, x2, etc. to xn, u equal to u1, u2, etc. to un, f of t x u equal to f1 of t x u, f2 of t x u, etc. to fn of t x u. Now, writing this set of equations in compact form, x dot equal to f of t x u. This equation over here is called the state equation, where x is the state and u is the input. And in similar fashion, we can write output y equal to some function h of t x u. These two equations together form the state space model. Now, if I write the state equation again, x dot equal to f of t x u, and if this input is not present in the system, then the equation becomes x dot equal to f of t x, and this is called the unforced state equation. Now, a special case of this equation is when the function f does not depend explicitly on t, that is x dot equal to f of x. In such case, the system is called autonomous system or time invariant system. The behavior of an autonomous system is invariant to shifts in time origin, since changing the time variable from t to t minus a doesn't change the RHS of the equation. If a system is not autonomous, then it is called a non-autonomous system or time varying system. Thus, we have derived the mathematical model for nonlinear system, and keep all these three equations in mind. Okay. Now, another important concept to deal with is the concept of equilibrium points. A point x equal to x star in the state space is called an equilibrium point if it has the property that whenever the state of the system starts at x star, it will remain at x star for all future time. For autonomous system, the equilibrium points are real roots of the equation given by f of x equal to 0. An equilibrium point could be an isolated point, or there could be a continuum of equilibrium points. By isolated, I meant that there are no other equilibrium point in the vicinity of an equilibrium point. Okay. Now, let's see what are the difficulties we face in analyzing a nonlinear system. A powerful tool we have used in analyzing linear system was superposition principle. However, superposition principle doesn't hold in the case of nonlinear systems. we can still analyze the system by linearizing it about some nominal operating point and then analyzing the resulting linear model. However, this approach has two drawbacks. Since linearization is an approximation in the neighborhood of an operating point, it can only predict the local behavior of the nonlinear system in the vicinity of that operating point. It cannot predict the non-local behavior far from the operating point and certainly not the global phenomena throughout the state space. The second limitation is that there are certain phenomena which can occur only in nonlinear systems. These cannot be predicted using linearized model of a nonlinear system. So, we will see what are these essentially nonlinear phenomena. The first one is finite escape time. To explain this phenomenon, let's draw a time response plot for both linear and nonlinear system. So, let this be for linear system. And this be for nonlinear system. Now, the state of an unstable linear system goes to infinity only as time t tends to infinity. However, in the case of nonlinear system, the state can go to infinity in finite time. Let this be some time t equal to t1. It is this phenomenon of nonlinear system is called finite escape time. Now, another essentially nonlinear phenomenon is multiple isolated equilibria. A linear system can have only one isolated equilibrium point. Thus, it can have only one steady state operating point that attracts the state of the system irrespective of the initial state. A nonlinear system, on the other hand, can have more than one isolated equilibrium point. The system state may converge to one of the several steady state operating points depending on the initial state of the system. Now, the next phenomenon is limit cycles. For a linear time invariant system to oscillate, it must have poles on the imaginary axis. And also, in this case, the amplitude of oscillation will depend on the initial state. However, nonlinear systems can exhibit stable oscillations of fixed amplitude and frequency irrespective of the initial state. This type of oscillation is called limit cycle. Now, coming to the next point, subharmonic, harmonic, or almost periodic oscillations. A stable linear system under a periodic input produces an output of the same frequency. However, a nonlinear system under periodic excitation can oscillate with frequencies that are submultiples or multiples of the input frequency. The next point is chaos. A nonlinear system can have a complicated steady state behavior which may not be under equilibrium, periodic, or almost periodic oscillations. Some of these chaotic motions are random, although the system may seem deterministic. Now, coming to the next point, multiple modes of behavior. It is not unusual for two or more modes of behavior to be exhibited by the same nonlinear system. An unforced system may have more than one limit cycle. A forced system with periodic excitation may exhibit harmonic, subharmonic, or steady state behavior depending on the amplitude and frequency of the input. It can even exhibit discontinuous jumps in the modes of behavior as the amplitude and frequency of the excitation is smoothly changed. For example, if we take the case of SCR, if we draw the VI characteristics, in the forward region, we can see that as the voltage keeps on increasing, the current initially increases very slowly. Then, as it reaches a particular voltage level, the characteristics suddenly jumps to a lower voltage level and then keeps on increasing. So, you can see that even though we increase the voltage level smoothly over here, the characteristics suddenly jump from this point to this point. This is called the jump phenomenon. Now, coming to the next point, frequency entertainment or synchronization. When excited by a sinusoidal input of constant frequency and the amplitude is increased from low values, the output frequency at some point exactly matches with the input frequency and then continue to remain as such thereafter. This phenomenon, which results in a synchronization of output frequency with the input frequency, is called frequency entertainment or synchronization. This property is extensively used in television synchronization circuits for channel tuning. Okay. So, in total, we have studied seven phenomena which are present only in the case of nonlinear systems. So, study these 7 points really well. Okay. Now, going to the next topic, that is classification of nonlinearities. There are three main classifications of nonlinearities. The first one is inherent or intentional nonlinearities. Inherent nonlinearities are nonlinearities that are present in components used in systems due to the inherent imperfections or properties of the system. Some examples are saturation in magnets, backlash in gears, etc. While intentional nonlinearities are nonlinearities that are introduced into the system by the designer for exploiting some features of the system. An example is different types of relays. Now, the next classification is static and dynamic nonlinearities. Static nonlinearities are those where the present output of the nonlinear element depend only on the present value of the input. We can define such systems as y equal to f of x, where y is the output and x is the input. These systems are also called memoryless systems. On the other hand, dynamic nonlinearities can be characterized by the output being a function of the input and its time derivatives. That is, the output y can be given as a function of f of x, x dot, x double dot, etc. Now, the third and last classification is functional and piecewise linear. Functional type nonlinearities are nonlinear elements whose output can be expressed as a function of input. For example, the output of the cubic nonlinearities in springs can be expressed as y equal to ax plus bx cube, where a and b are constants. While piecewise linear method is used in cases where the output cannot be expressed as a function of input. In this method, suppose this is a nonlinear function. Here, what we do is we split this nonlinear function into pieces such that each of these pieces can be approximated as straight lines, like this. Now, we will express each of these straight line pieces using linear functions. Therefore, this may be y equal to f1 of x. The equation of this piece may be given by y equal to f2 of x. This piece may be given by y equal to f3 of x, and etc. I hope that you got an idea about piecewise linear method. We will stop our lecture here, and if you have any doubts, feel free to ask in the comment sections. If you understood the lecture, please like the video and also support us by subscribing to the channel. Thank you and have a nice day.